am Simone Reyes, and I'm an animal rights activist, and it is not often that we get to stand in front of such amazing people and know that we're preaching to the choir. Usually we're yelling at people and trying to get them to join our side. But I think it's safe to assume that we're all vegans and that we live a vegan lifestyle and that we fight speciesism every day. When I meet somebody who doesn't quite understand where we're coming from, I often quote Captain Paul Watson of Sea Shepherd. If you want to know where you would have stood on slavery before the Civil War, don't look to where you stand on slavery today. Look to where you stand on animal rights. Margaret Mead's statement that one should never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world, because indeed it is the only thing that ever has. Animal rights, in many ways, is the final frontier. We are the truth tellers, the abolitionists, and the freedom fighters. We have a clear agenda, and we won't stop until we achieve that goal, which is total and complete animal liberation. Rocky, to say the least. It's hindered by the greed of big corporations, ag gag laws, and the stubborn unconsciousness of our brothers and sisters. But we can all see the destination glowing in the future like the North Star. We know that we will change the reigning perception that animals were put here for use as property and machines. But to reach our goal, we have to fight this cause with the same rabid determination as those that fought against slavery, pushed for women's rights to vote, and those that continue to fight every day for human rights, including LGBT rights. Grassroots activism works. Whistleblowing works. Undercover investigations work. It's easy to get discouraged because the losses are so big and the abuses that we see are so damaging to our soul. But if we look to other social justice movements, we should see that we will achieve what we need to. Ending slavery was a long and hard-won battle, but it was started by the activists. Early Quakers, many of them slave owners themselves, began to fight for the freedom of slaves. In the 19th century, as it progressed, many abolitionists united to form numerous anti-slavery organizations just like we do. These groups sent petitions and thousands of signatures to Congress and held abolition meetings and conferences like this one, boycotted products made with slave labor, printed mountains of literature, and gave innumerable speeches for their cause. Except for the occasional vegan potluck, doesn't this sound exactly what we are doing today? The activists engaged theologists and songwriters and poets and authors and even children to their cause. There was a constitution and a declaration. The declaration was drafted by William Lloyd Garrison and pledged its members, and I love this, to work for emancipation through nonviolent actions of moral suasion and overthrow prejudice by the power of love. The society encouraged public lectures and civil disobedience, nonviolent resistance, marches and protests, freedom rides, rallies, and the boycott of cotton and other slave manufactured products, just like we are doing for the animals. If any of you have personally attended or followed NARD, National Animal Rights Day, you're aware that we have a Declaration of Animal Rights and we all sign it. Being a part of the NARD ceremony is a very difficult one, and I've participated twice now. We hold the bodies of deceased animals. We cradle chickens and dogs and cats, goats, pigs, fish, you name it, and we hold them. It's important for us typically as activists to always have a stiff upper lip. Sometimes it feels like if we let our tears flow, they may never stop. Because of course we know we can't save them all. But at NARD, we publicly allow ourselves to mourn. We get an up close and personal look at the bodies of lab animals and slaughterhouse animals and what they must have endured. This year I held a chicken. I could see that her beak had been cut off. There were bloody gashes on her body. She was thin, and it was only in death that I believe she found any moment of peace. Others held pigs, their bodies black and blue. From what we know, were beatings being thrown about in transportation trucks and eventually discarded like yesterday's trash. But each of these animals that we hold, they are each activists. His or her bodies used as evidence, truth no one can deny. We hold kittens and puppies that never had the chance to know a warm bed or a gentle touch because there are simply too many of them. So on this day, we let our tears flow freely. We honor the fallen and vow to continue the fight in their name. Many of us even attend the ceremony where their ashes are buried so that we are there with them until the very end. During early activist days of the anti-slavery movement, which I go back to again and again, just as we stage our protests, they received national attention and cameramen documented the struggle to end what was an atrocity at the time. This is why social media is so important for our movement. We have it much easier, actually, than the civil rights activists did. We can potentially reach millions of people with one well-manufactured tweet, one viral video. On election day in 1920, millions of American women exercised their right to vote after almost 100 years of fighting. They made speeches and signed petitions and marched just as we do. Alice Paul was the leader of the most militant wing of the women's suffrage movement, even staging a 7-month picket of the White House. For this unpatriotic act, Paul and the rest of the suffragists were arrested and imprisoned. Along with some of the other activists, she was placed in solitary confinement, then went on a hunger strike to protest this unfair treatment. The women were force-fed for as long as 3 weeks. The leaders of this campaign didn't always agree with one another. In fact, sometimes their disagreements threatened to derail the movement. Sadly, sometimes this is the case with our movement. We have to remember that our numbers may not be as big as our enemies, but our resolve has to be stronger. The infighting that sometimes we see in our movement is sad and unfortunate, and I hope that this conference will help bring us all back together. I mentioned this. Activists cannot do this alone. The ALF can't be everywhere. We need to rise up taller and stronger as a community. As many cues as we can take from these battles won, I urge you to consider taking. As a woman, I've taken some slack for having posed for provocative animal rights and welfare campaigns and marched semi-naked against fur. But I believe in the power of the media, and as long as it's my choice, to me, that's what feminism is all about. About animals, then I've been successful, and if somebody makes a different choice in what they put in their mouths at dinner, then I've done my job. Our movement needs to grow by joining other progressive movements. We all need each other. Does it not make sense to ask all other social justice movements to marry the animal rights movement with their agendas? So they need our voice more than any other. The modern human rights movement began as a band of outsiders, fighting governments on behalf of the faceless and the voiceless. President Jimmy Carter brought it into the American foreign policy establishment by naming an outspoken Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights. This meant, for the first time, the concern for the poor and the brutalized and the imprisoned would be heard in the highest councils of government. We need to follow suit. Push even harder to get candidates who will advocate for animals filling the seats of Congress and other government positions. History has shown us that early activists understood this connection between human liberation and animal liberation. William Wilberforce, who was a well-known campaigner against slavery, was also a founding member of the RSPCA. Philosopher Jeremy Bentham, a founding father of utilitarianism, wrote an early defense of gay rights and was also an avid animal rights activist. The LGBT movement was built on the Stonewall riots in New York and has grown to massive marches here in California against Proposition 8 and continues to strengthen every day with every state's fight for marriage equality. Activists have led this charge. One of my favorite stories was activist and county clerk Sheila Rolex, She issued marriage licenses to same-sex couples back in 1975. When it was so unheard of, there weren't even any U.S. laws saying that she shouldn't be doing that. She told other clerks, just cross out the word man, cross out the word woman, and put the word person in its place. Can't we envision a day when we will be crossing out the word person and putting in the word being in its place? Backlash, and soon her efforts were put out of commission, but she made a statement and it's paying off. Not only do we have the first African-American president in the White House, but he has come out in support of same-sex marriage. The president's decision would never have come about without the activists, the thousands upon thousands of brave men and women who risked their comfort and their security to press for these equal civil rights. Can you imagine a day when the president will take her pen and give rights to animals, to live free from harm, free from factory farms, and free from pain? I do, because it's been done before and it will happen again. I believe in civil disobedience. I was at the Rose Parade this year, and I saw the float coming down, the SeaWorld float coming down the line, surrounded by SWAT. My friends and I said to each other, uh-oh, they know PETA's coming. And yes, we did manage, for at least on three different occasions throughout the parade route, to stop the SeaWorld float, and we spent New Year's Day in prison, and we had a great time. My hope is that one day this movement will galvanize and every slaughterhouse will eventually be occupied. I want every laboratory to be surrounded until they close their doors forever. I do home demos at vivisectors' houses. I believe that there's a time and a place for all kinds of activism. And I believe that if someone is doing something so heinous in the name of bad and dangerous science, and torturing animals, like what is happening at UCLA right now, that are, as we speak, sitting and chained into restraint chairs, with restraints drilled into their skulls, being addicted to methamphetamines, that the vivisector's neighbors should know about it. Yep. Sorry if sometimes that message comes loudly outside their doors before their morning coffee on a Sunday. I want us to gather, not by the hundreds, but by the millions on our marches on Washington. And as Ingrid Newkirk says, to never be silent at any fur wearer walking down the street or any meat eater at our family gatherings at Thanksgiving. We must activate the inactive and activate the activist. If we're going to follow in the path of other social justice movements, we must be willing to go all the way. I have stood on protest lines and marched in parades for animal rights for years, frozen to the bone in Central Park alongside the Suffer and Carriage horses in my hometown of New York City. And now we have elected, the animal rights community, make no mistake, has elected the mayor of New York City who has promised to retire them and get rid of the carriage horses. Guardian and watched as hundreds of dolphins were crying out for their lives, ripped from their families in terror, and taken to amusement parks for a life of misery, while the rest of their family were slaughtered before my eyes. I have seen the cove run red. I will never forget the images I saw there, babies desperately clinging to their frantic, helpless mothers and grandmothers, orphan babies shaking under tarps, stepped on by murderous fishermen and dumped out to sea, only to be washed up on shore a few days later. The violence of seeing men in wetsuits, smoking and laughing as they tied rope to the fins of dolphins who were watching their entire family fighting for their lives, wrestling them under tarps, many of the members trying desperately not to get away, but to get to their mothers and their fathers and their brothers and their sisters. The screams and the thrashing I heard will haunt me forever. My blood boiled and my heart sunk. So no, we haven't stopped this. Not yet. But I came home and with my boss, Russell Simmons, and my friends, Melissa Carbone and Trevor Nielsen, we wrote a letter to President Obama that was signed by every celebrity I can think of, from Sean Penn to Oliver Stone to Susan Sarandon to Cher to Jesse Jackson, the list went on and on, begging him to do what he can to stop this travesty, which we hope at the very least, via all of the media attention our letter got, and it did travel internationally, that it made some people second think their visits to SeaWorld and other amusement parks. SeaWorld's numbers are down. Their stock is falling and they are hurting. And this is because of the activists. When people go to SeaWorld now, they are almost always met with a group of protesters telling them exactly where these dolphins and orcas came from, where they were stolen from. Many simply in these amusement parks because they had the unfortunate fate of swimming through free waters past Japan. This is not Japan's waters. Japan does not own the ocean. They go into these waters of where they belong and where they should always live. I was with Ingrid Newkirk recently at Talladega watching our friend Leilani Munter race the Blackfish car that Sam Simon financed. I told her that every person in our box knew without question that one day in the history books, her name and image would be pictured besides those of Gandhi, Malcolm X, Bella Abzug, Rosa Parks, Gloria Steinem, Martin Luther King, Harvey Milk, and all the other freedom fighters in history. When people look back and they say, how in the world was this legal, what animals had to endure at the hands of humans? I told her that we were all so proud that PETA started this movement for so many of us, and she, of course, was too humble to agree with anything I said. But I saw it as clear as I see you all sitting here today. It's up to us, the activists, to make sure that that day in the history books comes soon. The animals are suffering now. The animals are dying now. They have no time for pleasantries. And as we say on the protest lines, as we stand outside of UCLA, and as we stand outside of Farmer John's and all of our other protests, it's one struggle, one fight, human freedom, animal rights. Until every cage is empty and every tank is drained. Thank you.